joining us. First tonight, fresh allegations that TV icon Sir Jimmy Savile abused young girls during his career have emerged today.
Now, the claims first appeared this weekend based on a yet-to-be-seen television documentary. Since the report, Look North has spoken to others who have expressed their concerns. Phil Bodmer has this.
Has anybody here got any ideas what it is to be successful?
Broadcasting icon, charity fundraiser, eccentric. But now the reputation of Sir Jimmy Savile has been tarnished by allegations of sexual abuse against young teenage girls in an ITV1 documentary to be shown on Wednesday. The programme includes interviews with alleged victims of the Leeds-born DJ who died last year.
I opened the door and I walked in and Savile was sat in the chair with the right side of his body facing me. And there was a girl of about 14 with long brown hair, sat on his knee. He had his left arm up a skirt.
Esther Ranson, who worked as a television presenter at the BBC at the same time as Sir Jimmy was at the height of his fame in the 1970s, said there were rumours about the star.
I feel that we, in television, in his world, in some way colluded with him as a child abuser, because I now believe that's what he was.
In a statement, the BBC said it conducted extensive searches of its files to establish whether there is any record of misconduct or allegations of misconduct by Sir Jimmy during his time at the BBC. No such evidence has been found. Meanwhile, friends have voiced their disappointment at the ITV programme.
I was absolutely shocked when I heard this because I was friends with him for a long, long time. We ran marathons together, was we in his company for a long time. He hated anything like this.
Well, this week's television documentary has led to fresh speculation over claims of abuse. Look North has spoken to a former colleague of Sir Jimmy's who worked with him in the 1970s. He says he saw teenage girls at his flat in Leeds and at the time had suspicions. He says rumours were widely talked about in Fleet Street circles, but such was Sir Jimmy's iconic status and his influence within the media that may have stopped those rumours going any further.
In the documentary, one 15-year-old girl claims he indecently assaulted her probably dozens of times. Another, who was 14 at the time, was one of several girls from her school who were invited to ride in the presenter's Rolls-Royce. She said, "I was having a wonderful day out and I was expected to pay for it. And that's what I did."
We're all ready as it happens, so here we go for a warm-up right now, then.
His tracksuit and bling made him a TV icon, but these allegations have taken the shine off 60 years of charity work and entertainment. Phil Bodmer, BBC Look North, Leeds.
Well, just a short time ago, I spoke to Mark Williams-Thomas. Now, he's a former detective who also presents the documentary. I asked him why he felt that allegations should be made now.
Well, I think it's right that these women have the opportunity to tell their story. Many of them have tried before to talk to people, to report it, and of course nothing's happened with it. Yes, I accept that he isn't here to face those allegations and I would like him to be here to face them. But the reality is, I think it's right that these allegations are out there in the public. After all, we know that those people who are abused as children, it's very unlikely for them to come forward at that point. And sometimes that takes many, many years later for them to come forward. And we know that speaking to these women, and indeed witnesses as part of the programme, there was a real fear, there was a real culture of fear about speaking out. So it really doesn't surprise me that they felt unable to speak out and really properly tell their story. And therefore, I think it's right that this programme is aired. Ultimately, the public will decide. And after Wednesday night, when the public have viewed it, I'm sure they'll give their response.
We have spoken to many of his friends and they feel that now he is dead, he can't defend himself. You would agree with that. He was also the subject of a police investigation in 2007, but they decided there was not enough evidence to proceed. How are you so sure that you have this right?
I think it is right that these allegations are heard. I think it's right they're put into context. After all, the amount of the evidence that I've collected, and indeed I've presented it to a leading Queen's Counsel barrister who's looked at that evidence and says, on the basis of what I've presented, he says it's the information is there corroborated. There is an element of independence, both the witnesses and the victims. And on his basis, he feels that I've collected sufficient evidence that would warrant his arrest.
Having said that, he's not here to be arrested. He's not here to defend himself. Are you really that confident that you have the credentials, you're a former officer, to effectively act as judge and jury?
Ultimately, he is no longer here to defend himself, but I think it's right that those people who make the allegations of having been indecently assaulted as young children have a voice. After all, let's look at some of the other recent cases that have been in a profile in the media. Hillsborough, for example, you know, the information is only now coming out. And I think it's right that we put that information out there. Ultimately, nobody other than myself and the small team know exactly what is in the programme. So I think it's only right that those people who are making judgment need to make that judgment once they've seen the programme, and the totality of both what those people who are alleging they've been indecently assaulted and in some cases raped, as well as the witnesses, are saying.
Mark Williams, Thomas, I know the programme goes out in 2 days' time. I'm sure many people will be continuing to make comment on this one. Thank you for the moment.
Thank you.
Well, listening to that interview now is David Glone, who's a lifelong friend of Jimmy Savile, and he joins me now. Anything that you've heard there has persuaded you that the documentary should be aired, David?
Not really, no, because we could stop it in a breath by saying you don't speak ill of the dead. And at that point, every interview, every so-called kangaroo court, which is what it basically is, needs to stop. And that's the end of it. Because what can you do? What good is going to come out of this? I'll tell you what, we'll hear their side of the story and then we'll bring the defendant on.
Which, of course, we can't.
Absolutely.
Having said that, very, very clear there by, you know, the presenter that maybe there was an element of fear that prevented these young girls coming forward. And that's why they're speaking now. Don't they deserve a voice?
Well, they deserve a voice. Whether they deserve a voice in public at this stage, I'm not 100% sure. Because, you know, it's what we do in this country. We have a prosecuting counsel, we have a defence counsel, we have the defendant, and 12 people decide whether it's right or wrong. Not Esther Ranson. Because at the end of the day, are they getting money out of this? Do they get paid for this production?
I have absolutely no idea.
Well, neither have I.
I can't answer that question, but there is one other question I want to ask you at the end of this interview, and I know you will be watching this. You're not going to not watch it, are you? David, is mentions there of rumours over... You were a friend for years. You know his other friends. Had you ever heard any rumours along these lines?
Nothing like this. Occasionally, with everybody in the media, people in the street talk. People will say about lots of different people, oh, I've heard he's this, I've heard he's gay. I heard that all the time, I heard he's gay. Why? Because he had blonde hair and he was eccentric.
But nothing of the seriousness of these allegations?
Nothing. Nothing like this.
OK, no. David, thank you for spending the time with
Pleasure.
Us tonight. Well, the funeral has taken place in Afghanistan.